As I described in an earlier video, the recruiting process for companies like Google, Amazon, and Microsoft for software engineers typically can be broken down into 6 phases. The most important of those phases for most people is the actual engineering interviews, which is usually 3 to 6 interviews spread across a day or two. But what do those interviews look like? What's contained in them, and what do you need to do to succeed at them? Hi, my name is John L. Miller. I'm the deliberate engineer. I spent the last 30 years working and interviewing at companies like Microsoft, Amazon, Google, and many others. During that time, I interviewed hundreds of people and I was interviewed dozens of times myself, so I have a pretty good feel for the process from both sides. Another of my videos talks about the full interview process through all 6 stages. Today we're going to go into more detail about the different parts of the 3 to 6 engineering interviews that you'll do as part of the interview process. These interviews are typically held in person. Now, it's not always going to be in person, so you may find that you're doing it over video conferencing. If you are, then you'll need to make sure that you have both a camera and audio, and there will probably be some sort of a shared collaborative interface, like a coding window or a whiteboard or possibly both. Each interview is structured similarly in that it has a greeting, a warm-up and possibly domain questions, a main core section of the interview, and then finally a cool down and a chance for you to ask any questions that you have as a candidate. Most of the interviews will be fairly similar to each other, so it's important to jot down notes after each interview if you want to be able to differentiate what you talked about and be able to remember who asked you what. So, what's in each of these 4 sections of the interview? The first section of the interview is the welcome. This is typically where in an in-person interview, the candidate and the interviewer will see each other for the first time. They say hello, make sure they know each other's names, and then if you're greeting in person, the interviewer should also give the candidate a chance to get a snack or get a drink or go to the restroom if they need to. They'll also typically bring you to the interview location. The important thing for this is that the candidate feel as comfortable as possible for this phase of the interview. We don't want physical distractions such as being thirsty or having a frog in your throat, keeping you from doing the best job that you can. The next part of the interview is typically a short, say 5 to 15 minute section that's a warm-up for the candidate. It's a chance for the interviewer to find out about the candidate's background, ask them some questions from their resume, both to see what the candidate has to say about the experiences, and also to verify the veracity of the resume. Different people write their resumes differently. One person may mention something and make it sound like they owned a whole project when actually they just sat in some meetings. Another person might make it sound like they just sat in meetings when actually they did everything for the project. So it's really up to the interviewer to differentiate between those things. Also, the interviewer might ask some domain-specific questions just to get an idea of whether the candidate really does know the domain well. Most interviewers will ask a couple of soft questions at this time too. For example, they'll want to know, why are you leaving your current job? Why are you interested in this job? Why would you want to work at this company? What do you want to accomplish out of working at this company? Do you want to move towards being a manager? Do you want to be a lead? Would you like to be some sort of a senior technical contributor? The way that you answer these questions says a lot about your motivation and about whether this is just a job for you or whether it's a particular job that you're very interested in doing. Given a choice, companies will typically want to hire people who are interested in the company and the company's mission over somebody who's qualified but disinterested. It leads to overall a better work product and a better work environment for the other people there. The bulk of the interview is the interview core, where the candidate and the interviewer will talk about the main thing that the interviewer wants to find out about. Typically, this is assigned by the person who's coordinating the interview, like the hiring manager. It'll be one of several different areas. These include leadership, resolving ambiguity, design problems, problem solving, and coding questions. As you're in the core of the interview, remember, it's not just about getting the right answer. This isn't some sort of an exam where you have to get above a certain percent right and then you'll automatically pass. No, instead, this is about finding out how you think and how you approach problem solving, how good you are at communicating and collaborating. For example, it's entirely possible to get the question right but fail the interview because you either solved the wrong question or you didn't do a good job optimizing it or soliciting feedback. Maybe the problem's not as well solved as you thought. It's also possible to pass the interview even though you fail to get the answer correct, depending on the process you took as you were trying to solve the problem. So the most important thing is communicating well and trying to work together on that problem rather than just trying to come up with an answer. Another caution for the core section of the interview, make sure that you use the time wisely. It's easy for two people who are passionate about technology to get involved in some sort of a side discussion that doesn't actually relate to whether or not you can do the job. The interviewer has a responsibility. If they can't gather enough relevant information about your performance on what they're supposed to be evaluating, they have to recommend no hire for you. That's because it's the safest thing for the company. So it's in both of your interests to do the best job you can of using the time wisely and making sure that the interviewer has everything they need to make a good decision. The last section of the interview is the cool down and question and answer. For the cool down, the interviewer tries to bring the candidate back into the world of sort of talking and collaborating on things rather than being in a problem-solving mindset. If the interview went poorly, they also try and calm them down, make them feel better about things, and get them ready for the next interview. Also, the interviewer will ask if you have any questions that you want answered. As a candidate, you absolutely want to have some thoughtful, good questions to ask the interviewer. You don't want them to be things that you could just Google and find the answer to, like how many employees are there in the company and how much business did you do last year. Instead, you might ask them, what's your favorite part of the job? Or is your group growing? Is it going strong? Does it have a strong charter? Things like this. These are much more relevant and much harder to discover outside of the interview process than those other more generic types of questions. Now that we've talked about those four sections of the interview in some detail, let's dig down a little further into the different core areas so that you have more of an idea of what each of those might entail. Leadership is something that's checked for senior candidates and for manager candidates. Leadership describes your ability to be able to build consensus, to get people to work together on a project, even if they don't necessarily report to you. But of course, if they do report to you, you should be able to handle that as well. It may also include other questions related to dealing with problems that crop up when you're a leader in a company. This is usually a series of soft questions. For example, you might say something like, tell me a time that you led an initiative in the company. Tell me about a time that one of your employees had a sudden drop in performance. What did you do about it? How would you handle a conflict between two people who both have valid ideas about a technology but disagree on how it should go? Focus on clarity, decisiveness, and inclusion. Another area that can be a core for an interview is resolving ambiguity. Sometimes this is a series of very explicit questions, such as a customer comes up to you and says, I want to have a cool product. What do you do? Other times it can be more implicit problems that are asked as part of other types of questions. Resolving ambiguity should come naturally to engineers, especially when faced with a technical question. Suppose the interviewer asks you, write a routine to sort a list of integers. You should be thinking, well, okay, but I need to know some things first. What form is the list given in? How do I know the length of the list? What do you want returned? Do you want the list sorted in place, or do you want a newly allocated list returned? What should I optimize for as I'm implementing this? Memory consumption, processor time, or execution time? How big should the problem scale to? These are all questions you have to have answered to be able to do a good job of solving this problem. If you just assume a bunch of things and solve it, then you haven't resolved any ambiguity. You may feel like you did a great job on the problem, and you might have absolutely blown it because you can't be trusted to work on something unless somebody describes the exact steps to take for the problem. Another core area is design. Design questions can range in scope according to the seniority of the candidate. A very narrowly scoped design question might be something like, come up with a set of classes that describe shapes and specialization of those classes for different examples of shapes such as triangle, circle, and so on. That should be a very straightforward entry-level design question. The questions can be much more complicated, especially for senior engineers, all the way up to something like, make a global messaging system that will be resilient in terms of storage and will be able to handle millions of different people using it at the same time all across the world. The design problem can be quite complex, and there's a lot of different variations of it. There'll be another video dedicated to explaining some of the details of this later. Problem solving can be another major part of the interview. It's often paired with a coding question, but it doesn't have to be. For example, the interviewer might ask a series of questions that could all be turned into code, but they might decide, rather than having you code the solution to the first one you come up with, to move on to another problem and have you solve that as well. This will give them more information about how you approach solving problems. Another key thing that gets measured in problem solving is your ability to iterate on your solution to a problem. This is a critical skill for any developer working at a big software company. You need to be able to take a look at your own implementation or somebody else's implementation of a problem, and if there's new requirements, or if you find that it's not all that great, be able to improve it without breaking it. Last but not least is the coding part of the interview. Most engineering candidates who haven't done a lot of interviewing assume that this is going to be the bulk of all of their interviews, and that's just not the case. In my experience, the coding part is just part of the core of an interview, and it's usually not more than a third or a half of all the interviews that a candidate gets, with lots of other things being talked about for the rest. So yes, it's important to understand the coding, but no, it's not the only thing you need to be able to do. A good coding problem should be something that could be easily described and understood in less than a minute. It should be solvable by anybody who's at the appropriate level, including an implementation, in less than 30 minutes. And if somebody already is familiar with the problem, they should be able to write up a solution for it in 5 minutes. That's the right scope of a problem that you want to ask in an interview. As a candidate, you also want to remember that most of the time, the problems you'll be asked fall in this category. Unfortunately, it can be difficult to know whether you're being evaluated for problem solving or coding, so you just have to kind of play it by ear in each interview. A good coding problem for an interview will typically have several different solutions with varying levels of complexity and efficiency. Ideally, what you want is to solve the problem quickly and then be able to iterate on making it better. Ultimately, the interviewer needs to drive the interview and decide whether they can get the best information from continuing to iterate on one problem or moving on to another one. And that's the five main areas that people evaluate in the core of these technical interviews. That should give you hopefully some idea of how it all fits together. Thank you for making it this far. If you have different experiences in interviewing, or if you have experiences that are similar, I'd love to hear about it in the comments down below. Also, if you find this video useful, you might want to think about subscribing and leaving a like. I'm going to produce more career-related content in the future, as well as some technical content about areas of interest that will hopefully be useful to people. Thank you very much for your time, and keep on pushing forward.